Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
My name is Kevin Kutz, and I'm here to introduce Dr. Nathan Myhrvold, who's joining us as part of the Microsoft Research Visiting Speaker Series. You likely know him as the first Chief Technology Officer at Microsoft, as the one who conceived and established Microsoft Research, and as the CEO and co-founder of Intellectual Ventures. His expertise in invention translates into his longtime passion for cooking. He has followed that passion from the kitchens of Rover, one of the best French restaurants in the country, but right here in Seattle, to the barbecue pits of Memphis, Tennessee. Dr. Myhrvold is here today to discuss his latest book, Modernist Cuisine at Home. He and his co-authors have collected all the essential information that any cook needs to stock a modern kitchen, to master modernist techniques, and to make hundreds of beautiful and delicious recipes. Drawing on the same commitment to perfection that produced Modernist Cuisine at Home applies innovations pioneered by the Cooking Lab to refine classic home dishes, from hamburgers and wings to macaroni and cheese. Sadly, he brought no samples of his work. If you skip lunch, but please join me.
Sorry.
But please join me
I
in giving him.
I hope people buy cookbooks more when they're hungry.
Well played, sir. Please join me in giving him a warm welcome.
Well, it is a pleasure to be at Microsoft Research again. So, a couple years ago, we came out with this, Modernist Cuisine, which is an encyclopedic treatment of modernist cooking. 2,438 pages, 6 volumes, and weighed 43 pounds. So that was 2011, actually, when we came out with that. This year, we've got a new book, Modernist Cuisine at Home, which is a modernist look at home cooking. In the first book, we had a philosophy that we would describe what the best way to do something was, even if it was impossible to do. Now, or at least impossible for most people. Now, I think that's actually okay, because I'm curious about how a lot of things work and how a lot of things are made, even if I don't actually do all of it. And probably half of the recipes in the big book, anybody can do at home. And maybe another 25%, if you really buy the right equipment and you are up for it, you can do it. And the last 25%, good luck to you. Because very few people have all the equipment necessary to do it. For this book, we did a different thing. We said, let's make something that everybody can do at home, but still has the spirit that we had in the first book of reinventing food using new techniques and new methods. So, like the first book, we've got lots of photography to try to make things very accessible. We cut things in half, so if you ever wondered what a Viking stove looks like if you cut it in half, well, by God, that's what it looks like. Like the first book, there's a washable kitchen manual. I was tired of having cookbooks that got really dirty. But of course, a clean cookbook is kind of a useless one, right? Plus, the book is so big that it wouldn't fit a lot of counters. So the kitchen manual is smaller, and it's completely washable. One thing that we're really big on is the physical quality. We try to have both large pages, really nice paper, great ink, so forth. Here's one example. This is the resolution of our photos. Now, ordinary photos are produced with something called a half-line screen, and it's 175 lines in a typical decent color photo. Art books will go to a 200-line screen. We actually use something called stochastic screening, which generates the dots randomly. Now, actually, we have a patent on this. We meaning we in this case. I was at Microsoft, and I'm on a patent on doing basically this idea because we used it for when we first, back in my day, we had to do half-turning in Windows because we only had 16 colors. That's true. So it's actually a technique that's there. Another thing that's interesting is the ink. We get asked a lot why our pictures look so great and vibrant, and did we use Photoshop to enhance them? And the answer is actually quite interesting. It's the ink. Most inks can't reproduce all colors. So here's one of the photos from the book where the grayed out areas are the areas that are outside the gamut of the ink, because that's the colors that you can do. And here it is with the inks we used in the Modernist Cuisine books. If you buy special inks, you can put everything there. You can see that mostly what it happens is in really saturated bright colors. So vegetables really suffer. You know, the tomato is basically gone. The chartreuse cauliflower is gone. The pepper is gone. The orange. We think it's important to have great ink. But one could ask, given where I am, why have ink at all? Why is this a physical book? I'm kind of a digital guy. Why would I do this analog thing? And when we first started the books, this Kindle here was the only ebook. And it's tiny, and it was black and white only at that time. So it just was not exciting at all. Now, after that, iPads came out. There's an iPad over there. An iPad is still tiny compared to the page size that we have. So if you want really beautiful, high-resolution pictures, analog is actually a much better way to go. Now, eventually, we'll all have super big, beautiful tablet-like touch screens everywhere. Not yet. So at the moment, we don't have any plans to make a digital version. The other thing is, simply taking dead PDFs and putting them on screen just doesn't seem that exciting to me. If you want to do a digital version, the thing that'd be cool to do is to then have an interesting user interface and do animations and simulations. And then it becomes a software project, and we'd rather write cookbooks. So here's some fun facts about the new book. Two volumes, 9.9 pounds, 684 pages, 228 of which are waterproof, 23 chapters, 210,000 words, 405 recipes, 114 photos, out of 86,000 that we took for the book. It's really wonderful that bits are cheap. And then 1,500 in there. So here's a few statistics. So the original book was $625. This one's only $140. Someone was interviewing me about this. They said, you know, the new book is so cheap. And they stopped themselves and said, you know what you've done? You've made a $140 cookbook seem cheap. Because the book at home is the second most expensive cookbook being sold. But look at the value, okay? 41 cents per recipe in the new book, 35 cents per recipe. Now, what would you pay? Don't answer. That's only $15 a pound for the first book and $14 for the next book, but Parmesan cheese is $20 a pound. So if you like Parmesan cheese, buy this book. It's cheaper. So if we took all of the text in Modernist Cuisine in Word, and we put it all in a single line of text at the point size, it would be 1.4 miles long. That would be going from Pike Place Market to the Space Needle. If, in fact, we did it for the big book, that would be the Space Needle to Boeing Field. You probably tell how I travel. So now I'm going to change gears after telling you a little bit about the books. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Modernist Cuisine, the movement, and why we did this whole thing. The basic ideas behind what we call the Modernist movement is first that art can be created in the kitchen. That's a pretty important, pretty fundamental point. There's a lot of things that are crafts. But craft is different than art, okay? Craft is paintings that you might buy or knickknacks at the Bellevue Art Fair. Art is what is in galleries and has got lots of intellectual pretensions and so forth. We think that cooking actually spans that whole range. Now, most people who approach cooking approach it from the perspective of craft or artisan rather than artist. And so you'll see bakers calling themselves artisanal bakers or artisanal cheesemakers. There's nothing wrong with that, but there's a real distinction between a craft, which is done sort of with one sort of approach in mind, versus art. And we think that this actually can be art. The other key point is that science is a set of rules that govern how the world works. And it's really useful to know how the world works. I had a woman in the UK who was interviewing me for a magazine say, "What made you think you needed to put science in the kitchen?" And I said, "Sorry, science was already there. It's the laws of nature. All I was trying to do is take ignorance out of the kitchen." Because the historical tradition for cooking has been, here's a recipe. Don't ask why. Do this, do this, do this, do this. And if you follow, do those things pretty closely, you'll get the right result. But I'm not going to tell you why. And then over time, people started making things up because humans are a storytelling species. We always wonder why. So people say, oh, sear the steak to seal in the juices. Turns out searing the steak does the opposite. It doesn't seal in the juices, it makes them flow out more. But it was a nice sounding thing to say. So one of the approaches we took in our books is to say, look, let's figure out how cooking actually works. And then empowered by knowing how it works, you can go and cook in better ways and in new ways. Or maybe you're empowered in a different way. You're empowered because you think it's cool and now you understand how it works. And there's a certain joy to understanding things. That's why people do science. That's why people try to do new things like Microsoft Research. And so modernist cuisine is this blending of art and science. It's about trying to achieve intellectually interesting things with cooking, breaking rules, seeing people's reaction to food, but empowered with knowing actually how it works. Now, modernism is a very old thing. Modernism is a movement that has been in many parts of visual arts. This is a non-modernist painting. This is The Gleaners by Jean-François Millet from 1857. It's very realistic. In the mid-19th century, that's the way all paintings were. This was the French academic style of painting. You'd find similar things other places. It was all meant to be very realistic. A few years later, you have people, this is Vincent van Gogh painting this. Now, almost the same scene, it looks totally different. It looks different because it's not trying to be realistic. It's trying to engage your thoughts and emotions. It's trying to make a statement that is more nuanced than simply saying, here's this gleaners in the field. Here's the same kind of thing, but it looks different. Now, today, we accept that as one of the major steps in painting and visual arts. And today, impressionist paintings like this are some of the most popular paintings in the world. But it wasn't always so. When you change people's idea of an aesthetic, it sometimes upsets them. So here are two cartoons from Paris newspapers in the late 19th century. One shows a pregnant woman trying to enter an exposition of Impressionist paintings. And the guard is saying, "Madame, it is not safe for you to enter." The idea being that the paintings were so ugly she would have a miscarriage. Now, that seems almost impossible from our current view of those paintings. Second picture is cartoon is similar. This was showing the Turks, a Turkish army, having bought Impressionist canvases to use them as a secret weapon of war. And the canvases are so ugly that the enemy is fleeing in retreat. Well, when the first chefs started cooking modernist dishes, the same kind of reaction happened. And I get people, even now, who will come up to me and say, "Well, I know about this modernist cooking stuff." And they have a visceral reaction because it's challenged something that was an important part of the aesthetic framework with which they view their lives. Now, of course, it wasn't just painting. There's also architecture. This is the Pioneer Building in Seattle, sort of a classic early 20th century building, and this is EMP. Right? Architecture went through a very similar phase of going from things that were very tradition-bound to things that were not tradition-bound. And if you looked at architecture like this from Frank Gehry's work, it's partially about breaking rules of the past, and it's partially making us aware of those rules. You know, it's much easier to make a building with right angles. Frank's buildings don't have right angles, but that's part of what sets them apart. It makes them say, well, gee, that's very different, and that's very unusual and interesting. So modernism is this idea of making a deliberate break with tradition, celebrating aesthetic values beyond realism, embracing new tools, new techniques, and new media as a way to explore new harmonies. It's a different approach. And in the mid-1980s, a number of chefs around the world started embarking on what I'm later now calling modernist cooking. They started doing things like serving foams. Now, of course, whipped cream is a foam. Soufflés are a foam. Actually, if you think about it, bread is a foam. It's a set foam. So, of course, foams were always there. But when they started putting foam on the plate, out of the context of whipped cream or souffle or mousse, these very narrow contexts, it shocked people. It was deeply controversial in the same way this Impressionist art was. But that was its point. Just as the point of Impressionism was to shake things up, that was the point of having foam on the plate or a bunch of things like that. One of the things that's interesting to me is I've discovered that there's a lot of misinformation about what traditional cooking is. So I use Italian as an example. Italian cuisine is probably the most popular cuisine in the world as a second cuisine. Kind of hard to beat Chinese cuisine as the most popular cuisine if you do by head count, because they got a lot of heads. But in terms of a cuisine outside of its country of origin, Italian food is probably number one. And Italian food has an aesthetic that really is about celebrating tradition. But that's all bullshit, okay? So contemporary Italian food, I'm just going to focus on three things. It features a lot of basil, not always, but many dishes have basil, lots of tomatoes, and lots of garlic. So surely that was always true, right? Actually, not at all. Roman cooking featured large amounts of black pepper. It was very spicy. Of course, one reason for that is it was also very rotten. When you don't have refrigerators, you know, things spoil. And in warm climates, there's almost anywhere in the world you go in a warm climate, they love spices. And in part, that was to mask the fact that they didn't have fridges. The most popular single herb in Roman cooking, it's right there in the middle. Anybody? Lovage. Yes. Lovage, which has got an intense celery-like flavor. It's you can find it at Whole Foods if you want to try it, or it's a little bit like the leaves that are at the top of a celery. But their number one condiment was something called liquamen. Garum was a variant of it. And liquamen is made by taking anchovies or other fish and sealing them in a terracotta jar and putting it in the sun for a month, which sounds disgusting. But, in fact, it's almost exactly the recipe for Thai fish sauce or Vietnamese fish sauce. So the Roman cuisine was about black pepper, lovage, and lots of fish sauce. In everything, by the way, including dessert items. Now, it sounds gross, but, in fact, there's actually a traditional British food that's a direct lineal descendant. It's called Worcestershire sauce. And if you look at the ingredients, it'll say anchovies, and that's kind of what they do to them first. Now, not only was Roman cuisine nothing like contemporary Italian cuisine, the cuisine of the Italian Middle Ages wasn't either. In fact, Italian cuisine in the Middle Ages was virtually identical to British cuisine of the Middle Ages or a German. The Middle Ages actually had a tremendous amount of uniformity of what people ate. For a variety of different cultural factors. Also, a lot of dishes that you'd think were Italian aren't. The first recipe for lasagna comes from a book called The Form of Curry. It's the first cookbook in English, 1437. Lasagna is an English dish. And the recipe, although it's very different than a lasagna today, is totally recognizable as lasagna. You roll out flat noodles and you put in meat sauce in between them and bake it. So people don't, when you say, oh yeah, I love tradition, the answer is, well, tradition is actually the wrong thing to say you love. You have to say, which tradition? When? Now, Michael Pollan is a great food writer, terrific guy, fantastic writer. But I have to poke at this a little bit. He's got something he calls the great-grandmother rule. Don't eat anything your great-grandmother wouldn't recognize as food. Now, I understand where he's coming from. His idea is to come up with a common sense, simple, easy to say way to reject the sort of industrialized food that fills supermarket shelves. That's really what he's after here. But I will never follow the great-grandmother rule. And here's why. Even just before you get to the great-grandma, my grandma was not big on sushi. Okay? My grandma was not big on hummus. Those are foods that would be completely alien to her, but they're really good. Now, there are other grandmas that were totally into hummus. Okay, if you're from Lebanon or the Mideast, then they were totally into that, but probably not so much on the sushi. Now, if you go back to the great-grandma, well, no more hamburgers and no more pizza. Pizza, as we know it, wasn't even invented then. Pizza is not a dish that has a long tradition. The simplest kind of pizza is called pizza margherita. It's made to celebrate Queen Margaret, I think, of the Netherlands, visiting Naples in the 1850s, I think. Maybe I've got the date slightly right. The late 19th century. So pizza is a brand new dish. And pizza in the United States is even newer than that, of course. Now, if you keep doing this, you keep going further back in time, well, great-great-grandma, you better get rid of your ice cream because, people don't have fridges and stuff. You don't have any ice cream. But even things that seem very traditional, at Salumi in Seattle, you can get these fabulous fermented sausages, cured sausages. Great-great-grandma didn't have them, even in Italy. That technique of doing of what seems like traditional sausage curing was unknown in Europe. It was actually a Chinese technique that came to Europe in the 1700s. While we're on it, espresso. Espresso was invented in 1911. And it was invented, by the way, as fast food, because what does espresso mean in Italian? It was literally a fast food invention that at the time had purists upset that it was not traditional brewed coffee, it was this fast food abomination. I kind of like it. So I'm going to keep drinking it irrespective of what Pollan would say. We have a high-speed camera. And it turns out once you have a high-speed camera, you can find amusement in almost anything. Okay, so that's a little bit about the background of modernism. The other thing with a high-speed camera is you become sloppy at everything you do because it's much more attractive. So I'm going to highlight a couple of examples of things that we have done that would count as modernist. This is our watermelon chips. We were doing a thing on doing potato chips. And of course, potato chips are quite interesting from a perspective of solid state physics, because what happens to make a potato chip crispy is the starch becomes a glass. To a solid state physicist, glass is a very specific type of matter. It's not crystalline. It's a frustrated crystal. And it typically is crunchy. The window glass is crunchy. You wouldn't want to eat it, but it's crunchy. A starch forms a glass in an analogous way. And a lot of the techniques for making potato chips are about how you can make this search class. Well, I wanted to make chips out of other things. And I decided at one point to hit on watermelon, because I figured if you can make chips out of watermelon, you can make chips out of anything. So how could you make a starch glass with watermelon? Well, the answer is you have to add a lot of starch. So we came up with a way. You slice the watermelon very thin. You put it in a sous vide bag with a little bit of starch. Potato starch works pretty well, not surprisingly. And you infuse it for a little bit, and then you can fry it up and get a watermelon chip. Now, why make a watermelon chip? Well, first of all, they're kind of cool to eat. It also hurts people's heads, because they say, well, how did you do this? And there's some interesting science. There's lots of little vacuoles filled with water. There's also air-filled vacuoles in fruits and vegetables. An apple, for example, is 50% air, which seems almost impossible to believe until you think about bobbing for apples, because they wouldn't float if they didn't have a lot of air in them. Why would apples float? And it turns out one of the reasons apples float and a lot of fruit floats is also interesting. It's to help get distributed. Because if there's an area with a lot of rain, one of the ways you can get distributed is by getting carried away with a flood. So anyway, under the vacuum, we can break those vacuoles and we can suck the starch in. And so we can take a non-starchy fruit like watermelon and we can suck starch in and make chips out of it. Well, once you're making, once you start doing this for potato chips, then you can do it for French fries, or as the Brits would say, no, these are the chips. We set out to try to make the ultimate French fries. And one of the reasons is that we think that any kind of food deserves attention in terms of trying to figure out what its ultimate expression is. It doesn't have to be fancy or have lots of ingredients. So we set out to make the ultimate French fry. Well, we did lots of different things. And ultimately, we hit upon dumping them into an ultrasonic bath. Now, ultrasonic baths are used for cleaning jewelry, contact lenses, scientific equipment. They work by having very high frequency, very powerful sound waves in the water. They're powerful enough that when you put in something with a different density than the water and different elastic modulus, little cavitation bubbles will form. And those cavitation bubbles will effectively scrub the surface, no matter how intricate it is. So by putting the potato into the cavitation bath, we scrubbed the outsides of our potatoes enough to microscopically put lots of fissures and cracks into them. We then soak them in more starch. So now we take the potato and we add a lot more potato starch to the outside of the potato than we would, and we create a lot more surface area, and we make the crispiest French fries I've ever had. So I'll just go quickly through this because I've said all of it. The idea here is that if you understand how a French fry or how a potato chip works, well, then you quickly get, you know, leads to all of these other innovations. This is a cool thing. This is a droplet of liquid nitrogen, but you can do a very similar thing with a droplet of water on a really hot skillet. If you've ever dropped a little bit of water, you see how they like race all over the place. This is something called the Leidenfrost effect. In fact, the little bubble here is floating on gas, because every time it sort of bounces down on the hot surface, it vaporizes some. Well, this is liquid nitrogen. Will do this on any surface. It'll do it on a on this table. We should have brought some, Scott. but it's also really important because it lets you do all kinds of interesting things, including, because of the Leidenfrost effect, you can stick your hand into liquid nitrogen. You can stick your hand actually into molten lead the same way. Because in both cases, your hand is protected by a thin layer of gas in the same way that these gas bubbles are floating. Well, we love liquid nitrogen. We cook with it in lots of ways. This, by the way, isn't in our home book. The home book, it doesn't have liquid nitrogen. There actually is a service in the east side here that will deliver liquid nitrogen. And when the guy comes to my house, he always says, you know, there aren't any other houses on my route. I said, God, really? Nobody else in Medina buys liquid nitrogen? God. The thing is, they're great at liquid nitrogen. Is that you can make things really cold without making them wet. And you can make them cold so quickly, you do really interesting things. If you put droplets of a liquid and you let them drop, usually by about this much, into liquid nitrogen, they form perfect spheres. The reason you need to drop them by a certain height is that's the amount of time it takes for the surface tension in the liquid to pull it into a nice little drop. Otherwise, it'll be kind of splashy. But if you have liquid nitrogen and a high-speed camera, you know, pretty soon you start doing things like this. One variation on this is actually useful for cooking is if you take raspberries or blackberries and freeze them, you can break them into individual little segments. Does anyone know what those are called? Drupelets. Okay, so you can say you learned something today. Each tiny little individual fruit that makes this sort of cluster combined fruit is called a drupelet. Well, liquid nitrogen is one of the things you can boil, but of course more cooking is about boiling water, so watch closely. Here, there's something down here. I'll explain what it is in a moment. Okay, so that's popcorn. And popcorn works because when water boils into steam, it expands in volume by about a factor of 1600. So let me go back and then back again. Okay. So what's happening is that the water in here is turning into steam. A tiny crack opens. This is a steam-powered rocket, effectively. You can watch it expand to try to leave the pressure, and then boom, it opens all the way up. Now, that's really important for cooking because it takes a lot of energy to expand that water by a factor of 1600. Boiling is incredibly important. And so we've got a ton of things on that in the books. I'm going to go a little bit quicker now. We got a lot of stuff on broiling and charbroiling. This is from the new cookbook. It turns out that most of the flavor that you get from charbroiling or barbecuing, grilling, comes from fat that drips down onto the coals. And that fat flares up. And you can see it flaring here for the shish kebab. People wonder why their grilled zucchini doesn't taste like their other grilled food. There's no fat in a zucchini. So dribble some olive oil into the fire. Or just put it in a spritzer. It works great. And then if you really want the fire from hell, use a hairdryer. Improperly applied, you can melt a hole in the side of your Weber. Here's that fat dripping phenomena with a high-speed camera. It actually takes surprisingly long to catch fire, again, because it takes a lot of energy into vaporization, but then ultimately it goes. Here's a close-up of those the fat dripping and the flames flaring up. One of the things we set a goal in the first book was to make the book visually interesting. You know, if you say you're going to write about science, to some people that's a turn-on, but to more people it might seem a little bit intimidating. If you say you're going to write about lots of technical cooking things, a lot of people who love food still aren't into really technical cooking, so again it seems a little bit off-putting. But if you have really cool pictures, you can kind of grab people and pull them in. At least that was the idea. So we've gone over all of this. It turns out the briquettes don't matter. So people say, I use mesquite charcoal. You turned it into charcoal. The process of turning it into charcoal takes essentially all original flavor out. Now, there are some charcoals and some briquettes that may burn a little hotter than others. So hardwood charcoal or will burn a little bit hotter, but charcoal is pretty much charcoal. It's the combination of fats and other juices dripping onto the flame and then burning, or partially burning, that makes the flavor. Then quickly go through a few other topics here. We love eggs. Eggs are a great thing to cook. They're particularly interesting because there's different proteins in the yolk and in the white, and they coagulate at different temperatures. So here we've cooked eggs at lots of different temperatures and broken open so you can see, see what happens. It turns out the yolk sets well before the white ever sets. And of course, if you have a high-speed camera, you see these? These are bubbles of steam. In fact, what happens, all of the bubbling, all of the sizzling that you hear when you put a steak in a pan, those are from little volcanoes of steam coming out of the steak. Or in this case, little pockets of steam coming out from the egg. The reason is there's water in there. And when it hits the pan that's maybe 400 degrees, it starts to boil. And as soon as it starts to boil, it expands and it bubbles up. This is our custard table. So this just shows what nerds we are. Custard is a mixture of a liquid and egg. And you can either do whole egg or over there is egg yolk. Well, depending on the concentration of the egg within the mixture, you'll get a different texture. But also, depending on how hard you cook it, you get a different texture. So we did hundreds of experiments to map out what's the ideal texture you can get with a particular combination. And so then using that, you can make things like this. This is crème anglaise, which is basically melted vanilla ice cream. But you can also do things like this. This is our striped omelet. Our favorite way to make an omelet isn't on top of the stove. It's in an oven. Because once you understand the right temperature to get the right texture and the right mixture of egg to other things, you can make an omelet much more accurately in the oven where you can control the temperature than doing it on top of the stove. Traditional French chefs will say, oh, it's a measure of the chef to see if you can make a perfect omelet. Well, sure, that's because you got a 400-degree heat source and you're trying to make the omelet roughly 158 degrees, so you got to work really quickly to basic, you know, just long enough to get enough of the egg to 158 that it'll set without overcooking it. Well, if you want that challenge in life, that's great, but otherwise put it in the... Then it turns out after you learn how to do that, once you can make them in an oven, you can make them striped. And we've got a recipe for that in both books, actually, the big book and the little book. Here's our scrambled eggs. We tend to be messy with how we do things. And again, if you have a high-speed camera, you know, pretty soon someone says, well, hey, my friend's got a rifle. And I can't say that there is any real cooking purpose to that, but God, it was fun. One of the popular recipes in our first cookbook was a technique for making carrot soup that we expanded into a whole chapter in the new book. I should say that the new book is basically all new recipes. In some cases, there's something inspired by something in the new book, by a recipe in the old book, excuse me. But we simplified it, we changed them. And so the idea here was interesting. Does anyone know why pretzels are brown? Right. So it turns out that in order to make pretzels brown, you dunk them in a highly alkaline bath, a solution of lye or some other very alkaline substance. So I was reading about that, and well, okay, why does it make it brown? Well, it makes it brown because browning reactions, the Maillard reactions, caramelization, occur at a much lower temperature if you've got an alkaline environment. So by treating the outside of the pretzels, you put them in an ordinary oven, and they get super dark without burning the inside, because the inside of a pretzel is generally pretty white. Well, people started doing that besides pretzels. They do it to pretzel buns now and things like that, because, of course, it'll work there, too. Well, I thought, well, hey, if it works on pretzels, how about carrots? So we started making carrot soup by putting carrots into a pressure cooker. And it, you know, pressure cooker is this fascinating device. It allows you to cheat the fact that water has a relatively low boiling point because the boiling point's a function of pressure. So if you seal it up in this pressure vessel, water won't boil until 250 degrees instead of 212 degrees. And that extra 38 degrees is actually pretty interesting because that takes you up into a range where lots of interesting things happen. Pressure cooker is by far our favorite way of making stock, for example. The higher temperature extracts flavors from whatever you're making stock, just much better. But could we actually brown in it? And the answer is, yes, we could. You get up to 248 to 251, depending on your pressure cooker and exactly how hot it gets. They maintain 100% relative humidity, so that means things don't dry out. Normally, if you want to caramelize a carrot or brown a carrot, you've got to cook it pretty hard, so that, because what you're doing is first drying out the top layer of the carrot until it gets hot enough that it can brown, because normally it won't brown until above the boiling point of water. But carrots are mostly water. They're about 80% water, so you're going to have an awful lot of heat that has to be applied, not inside the pressure cooker. Now, as I said, the pretzel trick lets you brown at lower temperature. The interesting thing is that once you do this, the browning occurs throughout the food. It's not just on the surface. Normally, we brown the surface because the inside is wet, and it'll never get to that temperature because it's still got too much water in it. So here's our caramelized carrot soup. And it turns this lovely color of brown, and it tastes intensely of caramelized carrot. Well, there's a shot of us pouring. Well, then, of course, we got carried away, so we do mushrooms and squash and artichoke and broccoli with Gruyere and so forth. All of those things benefit enormously from the idea of this trick that originally started with pretzels. But it goes back to this idea I said earlier. If you know how something works, it can be inspiration for something else. In this case, pretzels have been around for a really long time, but nobody thought to try to do this. Roast chicken is another dish that we really love. It's a simple dish, but it's also really complicated in another way because roast chicken is a contradiction in terms. To roast a chicken perfectly, you want the outside to be brown and crispy, and you want the flesh not to be dried out. But they're in contact. You know, that's like burning my shirt off without burning me. Okay, it's very tough to do that. So we set out to figure out how we could do that. And it turns out the answer is get chickens that are junkies. One of the things people do to try to make a good roast chicken is they brine it. And brining works for an interesting chemical reason. The sodium ions will modify proteins and complexes of proteins and make them hold water more. So brined chicken really is juicier, and it will really stay juicier than unbrined chicken. It absolutely works. There's just one problem. It turns out the skin is protein also. So when you brine a chicken, you make the flesh juicy, but you also make the skin juicy. And when it comes to skin, what we call juicy skin is rubbery skin. Because if it's juicy, that's the texture it has. Skin is rubbery by nature. It stretches. That's why we can smile. So we came up with the idea of saying, let's injection brine it. And we take a salt solution and we inject it into the meat, being careful not to get any on the actual skin. Well, that takes care of the inside. Then, I'm going to skip through this. This says what I previously said. We hang the chicken inside the refrigerator, uncovered, with a sort of a plate at the bottom to catch if anything drips. Now, there's two reasons to do that. One is stuff that drips out of the body cavity doesn't get on the skin this way. The other thing is it starts to dry out the outside. Now, that's a technique that's very, very old in China for making Peking duck. Because the more we can dry the skin out, the more we can get a head start on browning. Well, there's a couple other things you have to do. You then roast it for about 4.5 hours in a really low oven. Then you crank your oven up really hot and you sear it. And you get chicken that not only looks really good, but is really good. So although we love to have modernist food, we also are very happy to take something like this, which is comfort food, and serve it in a context that doesn't look modernist at all. In fact, we serve it on these plates because we say if it's grandma's roast chicken, we may as well use grandma's plates. We have a whole chapter on macaroni and cheese. And the reason for that is twofold. One is there's interesting science and interesting insights in cheese. The second is we wanted a book that had very accessible recipes. You know, our first book has recipes from many of the best restaurants in the world, but most people don't eat that way every night, so we thought, hey, mac and cheese would be a cool thing. And it turns out that there's an interesting science to melty cheese. Probably everybody has had a pizza at one point or another that had like a lake of oil and grease on top. And when that occurs, usually the cheese underneath is kind of gritty and grainy or stringy. Well, that occurs because milk products are an emulsion. An emulsion is a mixture of oil and water, basically. In this case, butter fat and water, stabilized normally with some casein proteins. Well, that stabilization of the milk emulsion works great while it's milk. You turn it into cheese and then you melt it and it fails. The emulsion fails, the fat separates. Well, in 1911, a cheese merchant in Chicago discovered a way around that. And he patented it and it made his little cheese shop take off, and his name was James L. Kraft. And that was fundamentally the first Velveeta. But the problem with Velveeta is it tastes like Velveeta. So is there a way you can do this? And the answer is yes. So here we take some melted cheese. We put in a magic ingredient. The magic ingredient is sodium citrate. Phosphates will also work. Now, sodium citrate may sound like it's a real chemical, awful thing, but in fact, it's in almost every grocery store. Among other things, it's used in Passover. It's called sour salt. Anywhere where there's a Passover section of the grocery store, you can find it. And what it does is it changes the ions, once they dissolve in the cheese, change the balance of charge of electrostatic charges, and they actually stabilize the emulsion up to a much higher temperature. Now, the thing that's great about this when you make mac and cheese is that most mac and cheese sauces use a lot of starch to try to keep the cheese bound. In classic French cooking, that's called a bechamel. You take a flour-based sauce and then you fold cheese in. And the trouble is it gets really kind of gloopy and it doesn't taste that much like cheese because the starch molecules inhibit the flavor. This only has cheese and a tiny amount of the emulsifying salt. So it just is cheese. And it makes wonderful mac and cheese. But if you cast it into little sheets, it makes wonderful Velveeta-like stuff, but out of whatever cheese you want. So then we kind of went crazy making grilled cheese sandwiches. Then we decided, you know, let's make them for the astronauts on the shuttle, so let's suspend gravity. It makes for a much better shot, so that's our grilled cheese sandwich section. I can't go through everything in the book, but we'll just touch on a few things. We have a big chapter on steak, including a cool way to do sous vide steak for camping or for a picnic, where you fill a cooler full of hot water. Hot water out of most taps actually will be hot enough if you like a medium rare steak. Put the steak in Ziploc bags, throw it in there. A couple hours later, it's all set. You just want to grill the outside or sear it with a blowtorch. Carnitas. Braised short ribs. If that picture does not make you hungry, then you're a vegan. And actually, I think even some vegans that converted late in life may be made hungry by that. Chicken wings. We have a whole chapter on chicken wings because, again, we wanted to have a less formal style of food. But then we got carried away. So after chicken wings, we started doing yakitori, and then we did satay and shish kebab, and so it's kind of a little things on a stick chapter, but chicken wings sounded like a better chapter title. We love ingredients. One of the interesting and false perceptions of modernist cooking is people say, oh, well, I prefer the farm-to-table movement, as if that's a different thing. You know, all food, great food, comes from great ingredients. And we love great ingredients as much as anybody. So we have a whole chapter on great ingredients, how to find them, how to shop for them, how to find unusual ingredients. Many of the modern techniques are really about unlocking what that's really an ingredient already, but doing so with technique. And much of traditional cooking is too. I had somebody say, you know, I prefer simple natural foods like a bowl of pasta with cheese and wine. I said, you're kidding, right? Because pasta doesn't grow on trees. Pasta's a whole technology. And cheese, oh my God, is cheese making intricate. And look at wine. Wine's even more intricate. And yeah, over a period of 1,000 years, people figured out how to make wine. But wine isn't grape juice. Wine is its own unique, wonderful thing. And bread is. Pastries are. Ice cream is. This idea that everything has to be a simple, you know, a carrot on a plate. Hey, a great carrot on a plate can be a wonderful dish. And if people want to serve that, I'm fine with it. But don't criticize foods that have technique to them unless you want to give up bread, cheese, wine, and so forth. A lot of people ask how you get a picture like this. This is our picture on cold soups. We have a raspberry soup. And the answer is you start with about 5 pounds of raspberries, dropping them two at a time with a high-speed flash. And after that many pounds, you'll eventually get a pot shot that looks like that. Of course, we're here in Seattle, so we had to have a chapter on salmon. We have a chapter on corn and cornmeal, on dessert. This is our lab. This is where we do all of our cooking. It's in Bellevue. It's great fun working there, I have to say. Besides making the book there, after our first books got finished, we decided to do a set of dinners. Because, you know, cooking is interesting. It's fundamentally a sharing thing. People cook so someone else will eat it. And while we made the book, we mostly cook for ourselves and each other or the cameras. We didn't cook for other people. So we started doing a set of special dinners where we would invite chefs from around the world, chefs and food writers to come. Here is the menu from one of the dinners. You might think, boy, that's a lot of dishes, but that's actually side one. Sort of goes on. There's usually about 35 courses. And here's a time lapse of what it takes us to set one of these things up. I should say that last year, around this time, I hired Scott Heimendinger. Scott was a program manager on Excel who had also had a passion for modernist cooking, in fact, had his sort of alter ego as a Seattle food geek. So Scott made the video, and Scott's there in the back of the room. In real life, they don't eat quite this fast. Usually, we get through about 35 courses in 3 hours. One of the really important things about a big meal is pacing. If things keep happening, you can keep people's attention. But if you like let a 5 or 10 minute gap occur, like around course 15 or 20, they're gone. Then I was like, oh God, when's the next thing going to come? And it's really important to do that. So we've had all kinds of famous folks, Martha Stewart, Chris Kimball from America's Test Kitchen, Thomas Keller, they've all come to eat, Wolfgang Puck's down over there. And that's what I have. If there's time for questions, we'll take some. Yes?
One of the hardest things for me to do is cook something and then keep it warm.
Yeah.
For a period of time so we can plate and serve. Do you have any technique on that?
Well, it's one of the reasons we love sous vide cooking. So sous vide cooking, at its essence, isn't about plastic bags or vacuums or anything else. At its essence, sous vide cooking is about cooking at low temperature. So if you cook a steak, you want it medium rare. You want the inside about 130 degrees Fahrenheit. But if you cook in a pan, your pan is probably 400 to 500 degrees. If you're charbroiling, you're probably putting on something that's a 1,000-degree flame. So you're in this wicked thing of trying to get the timing just right. And then trying to keep it warm afterwards, is really problematic. With sous vide cooking, what you typically do is you cook at almost the same temperature. So we would cook, to get a steak to 130, we'd cook it at 132. Now, it takes some patience. An inch thick steak at that temperature is probably going to take an hour to cook. But if you sear the outsides first, so that they're nice and brown, then you put them in the sous vide bag and you cook them. Or if there are other appliances, they're not common home appliances, but something called a combi oven will let you cook it at that temperature even without you doing a sous vide thing. Well, if you cook at 132, if you let it sit for a few hours, it's fine. Or if you bring it out 20 minutes early, it's probably fine also, because you're cooking with a very low gradient with time. So that's probably the single best thing. Other than that, the trick would be try to get the food, heat it with a heat source that's at about the temperature you want. So if things are medium rare, it's about 130 degrees. The trouble is most ovens won't accurately go to 130 degrees. You can try propping them open and doing stuff like that, but that's why combi ovens that will go to that temperature or sous vide are really useful. Yep?
I'm interested in your comments on the ink.
Yep.
So obviously we reproduce red tomatoes on magazines or any other using normal ink. What's missing? Yours was grayed out.
The color, what you wind up doing is you have to do something called color management. And another thing where I'll sound like your grandpa is, I put color management in Windows myself. I did, actually. scalable fonts, too. What you do is you take the whole range of colors, and then you try to squish it down so it will fit within the range of the output device. And there's a couple of heuristic algorithms. None of them work perfectly. But where they try to make the relative difference between those colors and other colors work well. If you've got a red tomato on a perfectly black background, it'll work. If you have it with lots of other things that are highly colored, it'll be less successful, and it'll be some compromise. And one of the things that good prepress people do, if they're adjusting a picture, or digital photographers, although inkjet printers that photographers use have a wider gamut than printing inks do, mass market printing inks, is you try to squish the color range in a way that is not too unattractive. We just bought the better ink.
It's about rendition, it's about accuracy.
Well, and not having to fuss with it, and we had a strong point of view that we should have books are a valuable thing, and having a book that had a quality job to it would be interesting to people. You know, most cookbooks, at the time we published our first book, there wasn't a single cookbook published in the United States for more than $50. And the analogy I like to use is if publishers made restaurants, they'd all want Marie Callender's. Okay? Maybe if a really high-end art book is more like Ruth's Chris, which are fine places, but it's not like French Laundry, Per Se, Danielle, Robuchon. It's not like these great restaurants. I love the fact that there's mass market products, but people also will pay something for quality. So he says, let's make something that's really quality. Let's try to have as much quality in our ink as we want people to have in our carrots and everything else they serve. Yes?
So how many inks are used in the printing?
So once you use the chromocentric inks, you don't have to go to too many more colors. I think we use 6 with that ink set. It's more than 4. But it's mostly the formulation that matters for the really high saturation inks. Yeah?
So how would you compare yourself to America's Test Kitchen? I know since you have a picture of Christopher Kimball. So how do you sort of compare?
Yeah, so he came out to visit our lab a few weeks ago, and then I was in Boston, so I went to visit his place. I love his stuff, and I've been a subscriber since like 1992. I think there's a couple of differences. One is that theirs is relentlessly focused on home cooking and home things in a very narrow context. They have a rule for Cook's Illustrated that they can't use a pressure cooker. It's too weird. Now, it happens that they're in the middle of making a book on pressure cooker cooking, so they're going to get over it. But that kind of arbitrary rule wasn't that interesting to us. One of the ways I like to say it is, when they're getting ready to call their recipe done is right when I want to really start get going. I mean, you're well into it and say, okay, now let's really go further. Another thing is just in the presentation, you know. They don't have photos of any kind. We decided to go with this incredibly visual thing. They try to go for very homey, accessible recipes. They said that it was a huge breakthrough for them when they finally, after bitter arguing, decided that they could put a stir-fry dish in the magazine. Because they have this idea that this is sort of Vermont country cooking, whereas we love doing things that are eclectic and all over the place. So it's basically a question of degree. We're kind of like them with the knobs all turned to the max.
So you're sort of like Alton Brown meets Mythbusters and
okay. I've been called worse. Yes?
Have you guys come up with a lot of patents on processes or devices in your test kitchen?
My company, Intellectual Ventures, invents new things. Most things that you'd come up with for food, you've got two problems with patenting. One is very few things are new. So it's not at all clear we could patent the pretzel technique, since pretzels were well known. Now, it hadn't been applied to carrots, but it's very unclear that that would be patentable subject matter for a whole bunch of reasons. The other overwhelming reason is patenting food only makes sense if you're going to make it by the ton. Okay, so patenting a technique that would be useful for home cooking or useful for a high-end restaurant is a totally money-losing proposition. So we did file a patent on our ultrasonic French fries, because French fries are made by the ton, by God. We've got a few other ideas like that, where it's something that you could make a ready-to-eat food. You could pre-treat all of the French fries, then freeze them raw or partially cooked, and send them out to restaurants to make crispier French fries. So that's an example of something where it might make sense. An interesting intellectual property thing is that recipes can't be copywritten. It's kind of a weird thing. When I was here at Microsoft, one of the things I was involved in many years ago was putting fonts into Windows, scalable fonts, vector-oriented fonts, TrueType, and so forth. And I was very surprised to discover then that fonts can't have no intellectual property protection. The names do, and that's why there's Arial, because the real font is called Helvetica, but they want an awful lot of money to call it Helvetica. And particularly back then, we were really cheap, so we went with a guy who had a made-up name for it. That's why there's so many things like that that have different names for what looks like the same font, because the name is covered by copyright, but the digital data is not. Now, with recipes, if you photocopied a cookbook, that would be wrong. That would be a copyright violation. If you literally didn't photocopy it, but you word for word stole it. But if you took a recipe, meaning you took all of the ingredients and proportions and steps, but put it in your own words, totally not protectable. So it freaks chefs out, because chefs think, well, surely this is mine. And the answer is, yes, it is yours in a strong sense, but not in a legally strong sense.
You're talking about two more.
Okay.
Have you read Harold McGee's book?
Oh, yes.
And I have a question. Did you, in your research, find any fundamental flaws in his food science that changed over the years?
So I loved Harold's book when it first came out in 1984, then the second edition, I think, in 2003. It's a fantastic resource, a fantastic book. He's a personal friend. The main differences between his approach and ours is he's got a couple pictures, but they're black and white and they're little. We kind of went all visual. And Harold's book has no recipes. It's really only about food science. It's not about food science in a really applied way. I think those are the main differences. I can't think off the top of my head of something that was particularly wrong in Harold's books, but food science moves on, and there's a whole lot of things that have moved on. So I wouldn't be surprised if there's something wrong. I wouldn't be surprised if there's something wrong in one of my books, too, just because as science moves on, or more likely than wrong might be incomplete. You know, there'll be a story where people say, oh, well, this happens because of this. And then someone does more research and say, well, yeah, that's sort of it, but there's also this other factor you didn't consider. Okay, last question? Okay, there'll be two last questions. You back there, and then you.
Where would you want to find ingredients
here? Bellevue Farmers Market is fantastic. We do a lot of the shopping for the lab there. Pike Place Market is great, too, but Pike Place has been around so long and is so famous with tourists that there's lots of fantastic farmers that can't get a possibly get a stall there. So the Bellevue Farmers Market is great. Uajamaya, we buy lots of produce at Uajamaya. We have a section in our new cookbook urging people to go to ethnic markets. No matter what ethnicity you are, there's some other ethnicity you're not. And just in Seattle, there's West African markets, there's Mexican and Central American markets, there's Korean markets, Indian markets, Chinese markets, Vietnamese markets, and they have lots of cool stuff. And you have to have a sort of sense of adventure, because and it won't all be your taste, I guarantee, but they also tend to have lots of really good fresh stuff that you don't find other places because it isn't, you know, the problem with a lot of produce is that it's such a mass market that it's shipped in from all over the place. Well, if you have something, a little local ethnic market, typically it isn't. They're buying stuff from much more local farmers. Okay, there's last, I'll be quick.
What did you have for lunch?
For lunch, I actually had Indian food. And it was great. It's in our cookbooks, we have a smattering of food from around the world, in part because our cooking team is from around the world. We've got people of several different ethnicities. Plus, there's lots of great food almost anywhere on Earth.